running device, and then I can dynamically see all the internal stuff. Typical one example is there was one bill, like a IP camera based bill, so where they have kept the JTAG port open, and then by intercepting these, basically like dumping the RAM from the JTAG, so we were able to get the all the request that has been going to the server and all the tokens and everything. So third one is your external storage. These days, I mean, this is not a big concern for very low power devices. So let's say you talk about Alexa, Google Home. So it is basically running an entire Android, or not like Android, it's a part of like Android and Linux kernel kind of stuff. So that is actually the whole firmware will be saved in an external unit. External unit as, let's say, if you take your PC, you have a hard disk. But in terms of your embedded, so they have specific chips like your EEPROMs, flash memories, or NAND, or eMMC. So they store all this stuff in an external memory that will be there in your PCB. So as an attacker, what I can just do it, I can just remove it, I can desolder the chip, and then I can use different tool sets, which we'll talk about, to extract the whole firmware. So from there, I'm able to get information. The same case, the same router, what I was talking to you about, so they had a external flash memory. So the same password, same configuration file, Wi-Fi password, and everything, I can retrieve it also by taking the storage unit from the PCB, and then I can extract it. That is still another nice attack vector. So next one is using vulnerable processor controller. This is likely to happen because if you look at, there are like two controllers, one is from STM32F1, and one is from your Nordic BLE SoC. So the problem is, so as I told you earlier, there is a JTAG port. So these have, I think the STM32F has a vulnerability called as a race condition, where you can dump the firmware even though if your JTAG is disabled. Same case for your Nordic 51. So that this is not really common, but since these devices are like, you can buy it in bulk and cheap in China, so you cannot really afford to leak, make your firmware outside from your ecosystem. So next one is like, let's say again, for example, you have external storage and then you have your main controller. So you know every single component inside a device is going to communicate electrically using small wires that is in your PCB called as traces and all those stuff. So what if all the data is transmitted in plain text? Let's say you are setting a password in a device, and then your processor is sending the password to the external memory to check if the password is correct or not. So what if I as an attacker can actually sniff that middle communication, and then what if I get the plain text communication? Then again, that is still a nice attack vector. So the next one is, it is not really recommended, but this is mostly, you can find it in all those POS machines and all those ATM swiping machines. So where once you open the casing, then it triggers a tamper alert. So from that, you can actually disable the whole device itself. So from that way, you can actually prevent people from hacking into your device. And then third one is your secure element. So if you take ARM or any of the most good processors, they have something called as trust zone, or their own trusted platform module. So where they have a processor inside a coprocessor inside a processor, which deals with all keeping all your information secure. So I have seen a lot of vendors who are using a processor which has that feature, but they are not implemented in the hardware. So that is also one of the common things which I see in a lot of devices. Yeah. So next is wireless. And I'm not just talking about your Wi-Fi or Bluetooth. This is your Wi-Fi, this is your RF, this is your wireless. It could be anything from 6LoWPAN, ZigBee, or you can imagine like whatever protocol you want to talk about. And then the most common issue is data is all not encrypted. You can just cap, there are a lot of sniffers available. So you can just sniff all the data and then you can see the data. The problem with once you get the data, you know how it works. You know the pattern, you know the format. So once you know the format, you can actually do a replay attack, relay attack, and then you start fuzzing the protocol by itself, and then do it. So some people do implement encryption. But the problem is either they send the key over there itself. So let's say, for example, if we have Bluetooth pairing. So there are a few key exchange mechanism happens, and the first key is being transmitted over the air. So there's a tool called a supertooth where you can actually sniff all these communication in the air. And then you can decrypt the communication. then it becomes pointless of encrypting the whole packet by itself. So, and also there's a common myth with developers and all those people, like having an encryption doesn't mean your system is secure. So let's say there was a smart switch where they're using nice AES encryption and stuff, but they have hard-coded their key inside the app. And that hard-coded key is common for all the devices in the whole vendor section. So by just reversing one single app, now I can control all the smart locks, that means the smart switch in the whole ecosystem. And then we can talk about the typical Wi-Fi DAuth attack and all those stuff. So now, what exactly is a hardware pentesting? So hardware pentesting, the problem with hardware pentesting, it's not just your hardware we are dealing with. So there are times where we get a vendor saying like, we want to test only the hardware. So, but that is not exactly the proper way of dealing with hardware, because hardware is just one single unit. For hardware to be completely functional, you need to have the software part, the cloud part, or whatnot, you can imagine, whatever. So that is also, make sure you, if you're testing a hardware, make sure you test everything in one single ecosystem or in one single team, so that there is a bit of interaction between the team. So you know if there is one single vulnerability in the hardware, see if that can be used to access the cloud part. So it is more of intertwined between each other. And people don't really consider hardware into their ecosystem at all, but they don't really understand that is like a huge attack vector. So because the problem with this, like one small, let's say you keep all your cloud, app and everything super secure, and there's a small vulnerability in your hardware, then the whole point of having a secure ecosystem is going to be void. And it's not like your typical software, you cannot patch your hardware. So once your hardware is out in like millions of units, it's gone, that's all. It's there deployed. You cannot go there to individual house and then go and fix it. And these are the typical examples, like your tap lock, Bitfi, and the Mirai botnet attack by all those the Who cameras, and then your typical car hacks. So let's talk a bit on the tools, on not exactly, yeah, tools. So the question is obviously what are the bare minimum tools you need to even start with hardware pentesting. If you ask me, there is no such thing exist at all. So don't keep going buying things which you see in like what, Alibaba, AliExpress and all those stuff. The problem with hardware is not standardized. There's no specific standard that is there for hardware. Each device is unique. Each device has its own architecture. So each device has its own architecture. They have their own protocols, they have their own standards and everything. So coming up with one single device for all the devices, it's like nearly impossible. Yeah, so what exactly the point of the webinar is, that is still there. Webinar is, and what exactly is hardware pentest and what is the approach? Because that gives you more insight on what exactly you want to buy, or some other Bluetooth communication. Then it's pointless buying some other, buying like a lot of other RF, SDR or all those stuff. Then it's start. Working around with that device, start new stuff, and you can slowly increase your tool chain. As I told you, it's going to be expensive. So that's why don't buy hardware in one single go. Get a project, get stuff that is needed only for that specific device, and then move on with what you have. Yeah. So let's just go again with most standardized tool where it is not device specific. If you are device specific, but you can still use it to some extent. So one is your analyzers or oscilloscope we are talking about. So as I told you earlier, you can actually sniff the communication between two different, let's say, a component in a device. A best example I gave is a flash memory and the controller. So this controller is requesting for a password which you have entered to compare. So there are tools called as logic analyzers where you can actually hook it to those wires, and then you can see what is happening. So most commonly used one is called your cellular logic analyzer. I mean, they are pretty good and they're a bit expensive. I think the 8-channel one costs around like $399, and then the expensive one, I think the 16-channel costs around like $800 to $900. That is good for professionals. But if you are just starting up, so there are Chinese clones available. password. So this is good. So the one of the advantage of this one is this as both your logic analyzer and it also has a two channel oscilloscope. I think it's 25 megahertz, I guess. Yeah, I think it's 25 megahertz. So this is really a good one. This you can get it for like $70 in eBay or Amazon. So for people who are starting up, I would recommend you to not buy any expensive oscilloscope. So oscilloscope, you can actually get it if you are working on something like sci-fi stuff, you are working on side channel, or you are working on fault injection. Then it makes sense for you to work with buying a nice rigol, nice expensive oscilloscope. Or else hand tag works like perfectly fine. And these are the tools that you use. That is your Cellulogic tool, so which comes with the Cellulogic itself. And then you have other Open Hand Tag, SigRock, OpenBench. And these three are like open source tool. So there are like so many other open source analyzers where you can connect to it and then you can start using it. Yeah. So in the previous one, we talked about analyzing the communication. So basically the whole point of this tool is to understand what protocol they are using. So what is the communication? What is the method or how exactly the communication works? So once you understand that, you need to find a way to access it. Let's say, you know, there is a password that's going inside. It has gone inside. How do you do to recover the password back from the SPA flash or any other storage memory? Yeah. So the most commonly used tool you can see it in anywhere is your FTDI, FT232H or FT232H. So we have our own exploit nano. So this is also based on the same FT2232H. So it supports SPI, I2C, JTAG, SWD. And the advantage is like it has two channels. So you can use UART and at the same time, you can also use JTAG. And there is like the infamous Bus Pirate. So Bus Pirate is a bit more, let's say, advanced than FTDI. The reason is because the raw FTDI chip doesn't have much support for all the protocols. So you have to actually write a wrapper in C or Python, and then you have to build everything. Whereas in case of your Bus Pirate, you don't actually need a wrapper. So Bus Pirate, the firmware itself gives you a nice interface. So you can interact with the protocol, let's say any hardware protocols. So jailing debugger. So jailing debugger is, I would, not for beginners, but I would really recommend jailing debugger for moderate people who are working on it. Because this is a nice, it's really a good and stable JTAG or whatever debugger. So it is really stable. And then advantage is it supports a lot of chipsets, like your typical OpenOCD or something. Yeah. So, and then if you take CC debugger, so CC debugger is mostly for Texas instrument based chipsets. So the thing about Texas Instruments, like everything that you find in their ecosystem, it's all proprietary. So even the debug interface, it's proprietary. So you have to use their own specific debugger from TI if you want to interface with it. And that is their way of making money though, yeah. So next one, which I think is your Raspberry Pi. People haven't actually explored that part in a Raspberry Pi. So recently I've written a blog on using a Raspberry Pi as your pen testing tool. So as I told you, all your I2C, UART, all the exploit nano stuff, JTAG, SWT, you can do it in the Raspberry Pi by itself. So we have also created a small shield. I use Raspberry Pi Zero. We have created a small shield around it. So where instead of connecting to all the plugs, so I've just labeled it. So for SPI, where to connect, I2C, where to connect, and JTAG, where to connect. So it becomes easier for starters to actually go and plug and play instead of messing around with the wire and stuff. And then we have our famous TNM 5000. This is also not for beginner. So this is, I think it's around like $400, I guess. So this is mostly for reading external memories. So I told you about flash memory, EEPROM, NAND, eMMC. So you can use this exploit nano to extract data from a typical flash memory or your EEPROMs. But when it comes to NAND flash or eMMC or other interfaces, the density is too much. So your FTDI cannot support that much throughput. So that is where you go with this one. So this works nicely. There are a few false positive in the output, but it really works. I think this is the device which you're talking about. So it has a small thing to just hook it to it. And then you have these small adapters. where this is for NAND chip, where you just have to place your NAND chip, lock it, put it in the TNM5000, and then it starts reading the memory. You can write to it, that's why not. And then next one is, that is all fine, but there are times where, let's say, you know how to access something in a I2C memory, but what if you want to automate it, do something around it? So it's better you always get a development board. Be it any board, doesn't matter, even a simple Arduino would work. Always get like one or two development boards, PSOC board or STM or LPC or anything, whatever you feel like. And these are the software that comes with it. Screen is for UART. I think most people have already worked with it. And then for FTDI, we have a library from the FTDI itself called MPPSC. So that is used for, that's like a wrapper where you can build your own communication using your SPA and I2C. And then your OpenOCD is for your JTAG. And then Flash ROM is for extracting your flash memories. And then TI Smart RF Flash Programmer is for your CC debugger. And JFlash is for your J-Link. And then TNM 5000, I mean, that is from Chinese, so they give you a CD with all the software inside it. So if you don't have a DVD drive in your laptop, then you have to find another option. So these are most, I mean, there are a lot of devices for SDR, but these are the most common, you can easily get it. So one is your RTL SDR. So RTL SDR, I think you can get it like dead cheap in Amazon. 35 is like for a good quality ones, but you can still get it for cheap ones. So RTL SDR, the problem is it's a raw RF sniffer. It works from, I think, around 70 megahertz to, I think, around 1.7 gigahertz, I believe. So the only advantage is you cannot transmit it. You can only receive it. So people only use it for receiving typical basic OK modulation and all those low-level modulation. But people are not aware that you can actually sniff LoRa. You can also sniff most of the sub-gigahertz frequency. You can also do a bit of stuff in the GSM network also. And then second is your USB to VGA adapter. So I think it was done by Michael Osman, I guess, or Great Scott, I'm not sure. So he had actually modded, it's based on PL2003, some chipset. So where you can actually use this USB VGA converter as a RF transmitter, which means they're actually using the clock signal or some sync signal to oscillate at a frequency, so it actually creates the RF by itself. It's not that stable, I've tried it, but it works. So next one is your CC1110 dongle. So this is really nice if you're working on sub gigahertz. So it supports a lot of modulations. So there's a nice Python wrapper using RFCAT where you can actually create your own communication. You can even create your own mesh network if you're good at it. And then if you're a student, and then if you want to work on basic like hacking into a doorbell or hacking into a security system. So we get a cheap, these small dongles. So these are like $2 to $3. Yeah, but the problem is it's a fixed frequency. So you can either use 433 or 315. So that is going to be a bit common, but these are like pretty cheap. So next one is the famous tool, that is my HackRF. So if you take all these stuff, if you take RTL SDR, you can only receive. In this case, you can only transmit. But in case of a HackRF, you can also transmit and also you can receive. So typical attack scenario would be like you have your car key fob. An attacker can actually record it and they can do the same replay and then to gain access to your car. This can do a lot of stuff than what it can see. So next one is your Ubertooth. So Ubertooth is, you can see it has something to do with Bluetooth. So this is also similar, not a raw Bluetooth sniffer, but it's like sort of a raw ISM sniffer, like a raw Bluetooth sniffer. So where it's not stable enough to capture properly, but it can actually capture your encryption key used for Bluetooth pairing. Once you have the encryption key, then you can crack all the communication. So next one is your NRF24L dongle. So this is mostly used for 2.4 gigahertz based devices. Let's say you have a drone, or if you have a nice remote car, or if you have a wireless keyboard, mouse, or wireless presenter. So this sniffer, there are a few projects called as mouse jacking and key sniffing, all those stuff where you can actually sniff all those packets. You can also do a replay. So a typical example would be like, let's say someone has a wireless keyboard. you can actually sniff all the keystroke and then you can get the password, or that's up to you. So second is your Blade RF. So this is also a nice device. It's a bit expensive, but it works really good. So you can actually set up your own cellular base station using this device. So there is a project called as 8BTS. So where you can build your own base station. I think it's since open source, you can actually change the source code. And then you can see if you can attack any end device or any baseband. And then if you can see if you can find vulnerability in it. And then your microbit. This again for sniffing is using NRF51. So this is mostly used to sniff your BLE communication. And then we have a USRP. So USRP is like the mother of all the SDR, but the price is so expensive. So it starts from around $2,000 and it goes till their pro version, which costs around, I think, $15,000 to $16,000. So these are the common tools. GNU Radio is like a MATLAB for RF. So where you get your raw data, raw RF data from RTL, SDR, or any SDR source. And then you have DSP blocks, let's say a filter, modulator, demodulators. Then you can just play around with it and then you can extract the data. Or if your SDR supports transmission, you can fuzz the RF component and see if you can actually fuzz the whole RF protocol by itself. And then you have a GQRX and SDR Sharp. This is basically like for you to view it. It's all like for basic stuff. Then you have a universal radio hacker. This is also for basic, like basic modulation, like ASK, FSK, and PSK stuff. And similarly, Inspectrum is also a tool to actually view the graph. And then these two are your base station projects. I think 8 is for Blade RF. OpenBTS is for your USRP. And RFCAT is for your CC110. KillerB is your ZigBee. 802.15.4 based framework for that specific protocol. And then the last three, like GATTACKER, BTLE Juice, BTLE Jacking, they are mostly, that comes in part of your Bluetooth BLE based exploitation. Yeah. And that is not a few tools. So you can also need to have a proper of, let's say, for example, you should have a lot of colorful jumper wires. Remember, the colorful is super important. Because while connecting to OS, you most probably will get confused and then you connect it wrong and then your device is gone. And then get a nice salting station, also a desalting pump or anything which is good for you. And have a good stable power supply, which can give you at least 4 amp from 0 to 24. And then you can get those resistors. I think in Amazon, you can get those bunch of resistors in a small box and a capacitors. I think that should be fine. And then you can get those pref boards. So pref boards are like empty boards. Let's say you have an SMD package and then you want to connect it to your breadboard or something else. So you basically like solder it here and then you just connect to it outside. And then, so make sure your workspace is ESD safe, because most of the device, a lot of devices I have actually bricked it because of ESD. So make sure you get a nice ESD safe table and all the handcuffs. So your workspace is like completely ESD safe. And then you get a microscope. The microscope is needed. Let's say, for example, there are very small components where you need to look at the part number and stuff. And then that's really good. That's really useful. And then you should have a lot of patience, because so far with my experience with all the reverse engineering and stuff, it all comes with patience. And also it's also a bit of creative on how you think. Because as I told you, if you take software, there are tools, there are a lot of automated scanners and everything where you can actually like find vulnerabilities. But because of a hardware, every single device is unique. So every single attack vector or every single attack, it has to be as creative as possible. It's not like you just do work of a script and then you get a reverse shell and all those stuff. Yeah, so this is for beginners. So you can just get all these, let's say your Raspberry Pi, SD card, RTL SDR, BLE dongle, some cheap soldering iron, some normal stuff. For a beginner, it would cost you around $100 to $200. I mean, this is something you can like bargain, like let's say you don't want exploit nano or logic analyzer, then you can bargain, like commit to like $70 to $80. So this is where I want to focus more, because most people would go for this. So this is the case where you can get exploit nano, because it's really good, because it's using FDDI, and then you can build your own wrapper around it. You can create your own protocols and a lot of stuff. And then you definitely need a J-Link because it's really stable. This logic analyzer, it depends. So what I would suggest is, instead of getting a oscilloscope and a logic analyzer, so there are nice oscilloscope which also has a logic analyzer. So you can, that would be like around $300 to $400. So I would recommend you go for that, or you can just get these individual devices also. And then you definitely need TNM 5000, because these days people are moving from using a SPF flash to NAND flash because the density is more. You cannot, there are very less, let's say for SPI flash, I think the maximum is around 64 MB, but NAND flash it goes a lot. And then you can get HackRF, or if you're good enough, you can get a USRP, but it's a bit expensive. So HackRF is good to go for that. And then you have your Ubertooth, that is for Bluetooth. This is still optional. So these days, Ubertooth, it works, but there are a lot of other attack vectors where you can still exploit it. So you don't actually go to an extent where you have to actually use an Ubertooth. And then you have your Chip Whisperer. So Chip Whisperer is also a bit of, it's not expensive, but it doesn't have much practical use. So the whole point of Chip Whisperer is for side channel analysis and fault injection. So you can learn the basics of side channel. You can do a bit of little bit of testing and stuff. But with my experience, side channel in a real device, it's a bit complicated. So in a target, they have a specific target. So this is the Chip Whisperer. This is the target board. The problem is this target is specifically designed for beginners to learn. But if you take a typical end devices where you cannot actually expect it to be so simple, you cannot expect to have a proper input in, data and then a proper output data. So you can still use it for beginning or some kind of a testing. And then this is definitely must. You need to have a proper soldering and desoldering station. And then other small stuff like cables, wires, ESD mats, and all those stuff. So for you people, it will cost you around $1,000 to $2,000. So I think that is still a good bargain to begin with. Yeah. So this is for lead people, you know, those rich people. So you can get all the expensive stuff that I mentioned earlier, and then it can start from at least $10,000, or you can even rob a bank. But disclaimer, I'm not responsible. So everything, so you can get the nice USRP for like $5,000, nice mixed signal oscilloscope for like $25,000. So it's completely up to you. Yeah. So the final note is, again, don't buy every single thing you see in the internet. Get a hardware first, get a project, get the hardware with respect to that specific hardware. And then you have a hardware. And then after the second, you go incrementally.
As I told you, don't buy everything. So buy things which are like incremental with your project. And always, if you are getting any hardware, make sure you get more than two hardware. So because even though your scope is only hardware, make sure you get at least two hardware. Because they are highly likely you will break one device. And then you will have only, then you will not have any device to test your vulnerability or exploit. So make sure you get at least more than two devices, not just two devices, more than two devices. And also make sure, again, as I told you earlier, there should be a proper communication between your hardware testing team and also your AppSec communication testing team. So because all the vulnerabilities are closely related. The one small excesses in the software might trigger something in the hardware. So it is always good to have a proper communication with these two teams. So I think that's it for today. And then these are a few references. You can actually refer it for some basic information of all these tools and other stuff. And then